Well, let's take stock of the budget. Joining me now, Lionel Barber, editor of the Financial Times, Mariana Mazzucato, economics professor at the University of Sussex, Jane Ann Gardier, chief executive of Virgin Money, and Fraser Nelson, editor of The Spectator. Thank you all for coming in. Busy day for you, I'm sure. Look, in a few days, we'll all be able to say what the budget really achieved or didn't achieve. We will have slept on it. What will we be talking about then, do you think? Lionel Barber first.
We'll be talking about the big picture internationally, which is one marked by pervasive uncertainty. Uncertainty about growth in China, the slowdown, the impact on emerging markets, which have driven world growth over the last decade. We'll be talking about certainly Donald Trump for the nomination, a protectionist. We'll be talking about several countries in Europe without governments. And then, finally, we'll talk about Brexit and the threat. That is the backdrop. Now, in terms of the individual measures and the numbers, well, I guarantee you, Evan, you won't even be able to remember the numbers of the forecast because they changed in a period of 3 months. Yeah. And George Osborne's got himself in a terrible tangle trying to meet his goal of a surplus given that the forecasts have changed. Lastly, of course, we'll remember the sugar tax, although it's 2 years off, the proposed sugar tax, and cuts in capital gains tax and relief, finally relief, for small business businessmen,
quite a bit.
Who they need to vote against Brexit right, in the referendum.
Right, that's so a sort of Brexit backdrop. Jane Ann Gardier, what do you think we'll remember about the budget?
Well, I hope that we remember that we live in a thriving economy. And to me, that's something that's been missed today. You know, we've got high employment, and this budget's about driving employment. We've got wage growth. And although wage growth may have slowed slightly, we've got taxation benefits that mean that people have got more disposable income. I think the fact that oil prices have come down has given consumers greater confidence, and I think that's encouraged everyone. And I think the fact that the Chancellor has today helped the oil industry make that more level too. So I think a good, strong economy for the future. And actually, I think that this budget's built on that, and that's something that we should look at positively.
And you're one of the... I don't know if it means you're a supporter, but you're on a kind of business council for the Chancellor, correct?
I'm in the Prime Minister's business advisory group.
Exactly. And so, I mean, in a broad business sense, because actually there was a bit of a tax hit on bigger businesses, wasn't there? I mean, he obviously learned his lesson from Google and thought, I'd better hit big business and give it to small businesses. You're not complaining about that or anything?
No, I think that the tax position in terms of managing corporation tax is a wise thing to do. 1% reduction in corporation tax, I think, will mean that businesses do bring more of their profits into the UK, and that will pay for itself very easily in that way, and encourage investment into the UK. And obviously that's very important for all of us.
Mariana, you're... We have to say an advisor to John McDonnell. You're one of the seven, his panel of seven, aren't you? We'll talk about their policy in a minute. But what did you make of this budget?
Well, I mean, I think it'll be remembered for just how short-term and quite superficial it was, because it didn't tackle the sources of the problem. It had lots of sort of token measures. So in terms of productivity, how to solve the productivity problem is actually about really increasing both public and private investment. And private investment, which is falling in this country, will not increase simply through tax cuts. Tax cuts in the short term are simply making profits increase. Profits continue actually to be at record highs. If we want to be like the US, which Sajid Javid was saying, then let's increase corporate income tax to what it is in the US, which is 39%. Just to say that is not actually, there's no evidence, there's no empirical evidence that cutting capital gains tax or cutting corporate income tax is going to increase business investment.
Well, let's just go back to Jane Ann on that before I come to you, Fraser. Is that correct? On the productivity side, boosting investment clearly helpful. Tax important or not?
Well, I think tax is very important. I think that enabling small businesses to invest in their own development is really important. And I think that small businesses in this country deserve further investment, further support from the Chancellor. And I think that they actually got it today. So I absolutely encourage that.
But small businesses internationally, from the ones in Israel to the US, in China, you want them to actually grow. You don't want them to remain small. And what small businesses need, therefore, is patient, long-term, committed finance. What did we do with the few attempts in this country to get the kind of finance? We privatized the business bank. We privatized the Green Investment Bank. Those are the kind of sort of real sort of concrete tools that actually will increase investment and innovation in this country. We are turning BIS, the Business Innovation and Skills Department, into an enterprise zone. You know, low regulation, low tax, come here. We want to be like Ireland? Fine.
I need to bring Fraser. So, Fraser, what struck you about this budget? Because quite a lot of different chancellors on show. I mean, they're a bit of a mashup of Thatcher and Heather and a little bit of Gordon Brown tricksiness in there. I mean, there's quite a lot in...
There is, but he had a political objective here, and that was to annoy as few Conservatives as he can before the referendum. I mean, he could not afford another omni-shambles budget. You got the feeling he went for the last 3 weeks just weeding out anything that could be seen to cause a political problem for him down the road. And so, yes, he chose the sugar tax, predominantly a tax on the poor, which I think is a horribly regressive measure, but it is one that the Labour Party welcomed instantly, and the Lib Dems, a sure sign it's a bad idea. But by and large, there was enough to keep Tories happy, a small cut in corporation tax, a small increase in the threshold. So it smooths the way for the EU vote, which is all he's really thinking about right now.
Mm. Can I just ask you all about this devolution package? Because no one ever seems to talk about this, but step by step, we're getting quite a big reshaping of the country, aren't we, Lionel, with mayors and regional governments and joining up authorities, and it's the Chancellor who's leading it. I don't know why it's his...
Well, I look forward to the new Wessex Regional Authority. I mean, they're really going back to back to the old region.
Yeah.
But there is a serious point here. Certainly, we at the Financial Times have argued for a long time that this country is too centralised, too much built around Whitehall, and if you're seeing the kind of devolution that we've seen in the last couple of years in Scotland, then you need to have some compensating factors in England. But of course, there is a sting in the tail here. The Chancellor talked eloquently as ever about the devolution revolution, and yet here is a government that's actually really nationalising education policy,
even
to the point of just dictating that everybody should study maths until they're 18 years old. But I gather late tonight that may be now receding into the distance.
Right. We heard one of those constituents in Wiltshire, Fraser, talking about it being a socialist chancellor.
But well, you can completely see why. I mean,
can you really?
Yeah,
is this really a socialist chancellor?
But look at all the ideas he's grave dropped from Ed Balls. I mean, you've got the £9 minimum wage that's going to destroy something from 60 to 300,000 jobs, depending on which economist you believe in. You've got the bashing of the big banks that never stops. Look at the budgets today. He tells you all of the good causes he's giving all the bank fines to draw this moral evil banks, let's give them to the nice people. He's now talking about big business, now apparently bad. He's going to help it towards small business, good. Again, he's using a lot of language, and it does make Conservatives wonder why he bothered winning a majority. If he's going to implement all of these Labour ideas. I mean, ask yourself, what in this budget couldn't really have been delivered by a Labour Chancellor? There isn't that much.
That's completely
it's called
wrong.
The centre ground.
I mean, this is an incredibly regressive budget. I mean, you know,
sugar tax.
The income tax
the
cuts are also benefiting
from, you know, the poor to the rich through these different measures is not a socialist.
How are your guys doing? What do you think? Is there an alternative at the moment?
Absolutely. But I mean, you have to start with the numbers. You were talking to Seema about numbers. The numbers are very worrying in terms of, you know, families. We have the projection of something like 164% of household debt to disposable income. This is bringing us back to the levels of indebtedness that we had just before the crisis.
And how is the Labour Party, in your view, I mean, you're an advisor to them, doing in terms of framing a good alternative, credible alternative?
Well, I mean, I think this emphasis on the strategic state, which I'm, you know, happy if you want, was informed from my entrepreneurial state. But I mean, I think that really has to be carried through systematically. It shouldn't just be used, if you want, as a token measure. So having actually an agenda which is focused on investment-led growth as opposed to consumption-led growth, which continues to be the situation here. Therefore, debt to income levels
that's
rising.
That's been keeping us going over the last 5 years.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but we don't want that. No, I'm saying we need investment-led growth. So what we need is a coherent plan on how to do that, and that also means actually strengthening, and not weakening, those public institutions that will actually allow us, like the U.S., to have that kind of growth.
We need to leave it there. Thank you all very much. Well, that is.